How do you achieve these perfectly smooth and aerodynamic curves that are the key to speed? So effective is the streamlining, this crazy fast little machine can cruise effortlessly at 360 kilometers an hour.
Wow!
On 60% throttle. And faster than that, we couldn't get any useful footage. It's too small and quick. So how fast can it go when it really tries? Luke, my son, asked me if I wanted to help him bring the Guinness record for the fastest quadcopter to the bottom tip of Africa. When he graduated as a mechatronic engineer, I never imagined he would make cool stuff on YouTube and we would get to play together. Between us, we had all the entrepreneurial, engineering, and design skills necessary to smash the record. And it helped that we shared the same extreme enthusiasm for cool projects. This has been a mission for the past 9 months. Design is a journey. You test ideas, learn along the way. Some ideas work and others don't. Failure and feeling disheartened is a given in engineering, which makes getting the Guinness certificate all the sweeter. We had to lock in the frame size before having the complete design or knowing the full picture. This is very typical of how design works. You don't have the luxury of knowing all things when you start out. Question was how long to make the carbon fiber arms. We had just two options of extreme high-pitch props. The 5-inch ones would spin so fast their tips would go supersonic. And so we went with the 7-inch. A bigger frame meant more drag, so bunching the props close together made sense. But the instability forces at such high speed are huge. Longer arms would allow the motors to run closer to 100% during the speed boost because less differential thrust is required to maintain directional control. And the props would be working in clean air. The maximum print size of our bamboo carbon printer is a convenient way to set the length of the arms. In hindsight, this dimension seems close to optimal. With our next version, we have lots of data and experience to optimize this decision further. This design started with little brother Peregreen 1. It reached an already crazy 400 kilometers an hour. But how could we not try and go faster? At its core, this design revolved around maximum power from the battery to motors. With so much power, the bottleneck was the motor speed controller. Version 1 had a single controller to handle the power to all four motors, and it was maxed out and overheating. These controllers are switches that adjust the speed of each motor thousands of times per second and manage huge amounts of current. They get very hot and can be fragile and temperamental. We were going to need four controllers to handle the 9 kilowatt or 12 horsepower Luke had in mind. Full throttle lasts just 7 seconds, and after that, they are so hammered there's just enough to land. The positioning of these four controllers dictated the placement of everything else, whilst maintaining the most compact design. Version 1 was wasting engine power just trying to stabilize and go straight, instead of going to forward thrust. So a longer tail to accommodate the motor controllers seemed like an obvious solution. And placed on the outside, they could get excellent cooling. Smart move, right? No, the wiring proved to be a nightmare and not fun to fit. We were growing concerned that the large increase in body surface area would come at high cost of drag and cancel out the extra power. Only way to find out was to fly it and see. On its first flight, a motor controller caught a light spectacularly. After a rebuild, it had identical repeat performance. Our best explanation was the moment a motor rotated when it touched the ground, the controller drew massive power from the battery and started sparking. I am keeping this tailpiece to admire whenever I am pondering the mysteries of life. This arrangement had an inefficient amount of surface area and not compact enough for the speed we were eyeing. So it was back to the pencil and a complete redesign. The motor cones and arm fairings make up close to half the total body surface area, and so their placement has a major impact on the aerodynamic center of the body. Whilst placed over the center of gravity or pivot point, they did not contribute any stability and only produce drag. Weight needs to be as far forward as possible and surface area as far back as you can get it. This arrangement achieved this for improved directional stability without a long tail. Moving the fairings rearward meant they actively provided a weather vane effect to help it go straight. Twin batteries delivered 48 volts. This higher voltage allowed thinner wires, less heat, and higher RPMs. The batteries were stacked one above the other. This gave it a rectangular profile. And in the side-to-side motion, or yaw, there was a large body surface area, and this required a tail to keep it straight. In the nose-up or nose-down, the exposed area was less. It was naturally stable in this direction. The size of the tail was worked out by good old-fashioned out-of-the-window wind tunnel testing. During test flying, Luke felt better control with the tail than without. The redesign had the speed controllers placed under the batteries on the forward side of the frame. This required legs for the batteries, but moving the batteries away from the central frame introduces a potentially serious problem. The batteries are the single heaviest component, and it's essential they are rigidly attached to the frame so there is no wobble or oscillation to confuse the control gyros. Wobble and resonance causes nonsensical switching commands to the motors, which throws away power and overheats the motors. Too much wobble and you crash. There was the added risk of the heat from components collapsing the legs, and after some testing, we selected a more heat-resistant filament and added cross-bracing with beefy legs to ensure rigidity. This optimized placement of the controllers reduced the overall length from 490 to 400 millimeters. It may be counterintuitive, but props at the rear will not impact directional stability, provided the central thrust line passes through the center of gravity, keeping everything balanced. We had arrived at Peregreen 2, but we're going to need good ventilation on the inside for the electronics. We chose the classic Nacker duct. As the airstream tumbles over the sharp edges, two counter-rotating mini vortices form, which encourage more air inside. It doesn't protrude, making it low drag while delivering surprisingly effective airflow to the hot components. And it has a pleasing shape that looks fast. By far the most time-consuming part of the design was modeling the body parts. The main aerodynamic outer surface was sliced into five main panels. The joints needed flanges to ensure their alignment, so there was no step to create drag. The prints were planned with weak points placed strategically so parts could snap, allowing the critical pieces to survive. The trailing edge was printed from flexible filament to simplify the installation of the motor wiring. For the canopy, we printed poly-smooth PVA filament in vase mode and sprayed them with isopropyl mist for about 5 days. This made for a super strong canopy. Sending parts to the bamboo printer was an easy part of the process. As a newcomer, I found this easy and intuitive. It's the Apple of 3D printing. I have Luke reminding me that I'm spoiled because I've been spared the pain and frustration of back in the day before bamboo revolutionized this process, making everything a breeze. For maximum speed, this was primarily a task of wrapping the motors, the arms, and the battery inside the most efficient streamlined shape, making the shell no larger than absolutely necessary, with the battery corners a mere 1 millimeter under the surface and the motor cones precisely aligned. The shape starts out as 5 cylinders. For the arms, these rectangles are bridged and the software generates these elegantly sculpted streamlined curves. I meticulously tweaked the vertex points till the shape was just right, and then subdividing the mesh into ever smaller rectangles till the flat faces disappear into a continuous curve. The camera in the nose tilts from a servo for perfect view during high speed and during landing. The HD video feed is transmitted via the antenna in the tail to Luke's goggles, so he can see where he is going. Live telemetry is also displayed in the goggles to monitor speed, RPM, temperatures and voltage, etc. The Guinness Record witnesses could watch the camera feed live on an iPad during the speed runs. We had assembled three witnesses to observe the best two 100 meter runs from four flights for Guinness verification. We were really looking forward to seeing Peregreen 1 flying alongside its big brother. Darren, who is an FPV champion, was flying and act as the camera drone. It lifted off with big brother, but sadly it was overcome by the moment and just ended up buzzing and wobbling.
Maybe land that, Darren.
Dad went to fetch it to spare it further embarrassment. The clip for securing the lid took lots of development. The latch clip is printed as part of the lid and pre-sprung so it positively engages the catch. And the result was a very satisfying double-click confirmation that it was locked, and it worked flawlessly. Except for flight 2, where I rushed things and didn't latch it correctly. During the pull-up, after the speed section, the high G-forces lifted the lid, which almost completely obscured the camera view. Luke kept his cool and with some fabulous flying skill brought it back in one piece, just missing a hangar while flying blind.
Yeah, good job.
Yes.
Luke and I share engineer brains, but we also understand that top-tier products must not only perform exceptionally, but also exude a sense of coolness. Success is achieving excellence in both performance and aesthetics. From version 1, we knew a tiny object zooming by at incredible speeds was a challenge for spectators to track visually. They mostly just heard it scream by, and a common response was laughter, because it just didn't compute that something that small can go so fast. Luke proposed a brilliant solution, installing super bright LEDs in the tail. The final world record flight was after sunset, and we got this fantastic footage of it streaking across the sky. For once, the entire audience got to see this crazy small machine at full throttle. And the impressive performance wasn't lost in a blur. Luke got to show off more hyper-skilled piloting, landing in darkness, aware that there was no time to get lost because the batteries were at empty. There would not be a record if it did not come back in one piece. It was the perfect closure to four cracker world record flights.
Oh my god!
500 kilometers an hour.
Nice. Yeah. It was so fast.
Just kept it going.
Jeez, you guys should film these batteries.
Are they like single use?
An incredible 510 kilometers per hour on flight 1. Peregreen 2 clocked an incredible 452 on flight 3. The average speed of 480.23 kilometers per hour was a new record by a large margin, and in large part thanks to the magnificent streamlining of the body. For Peregreen 3, we're taking the aerodynamics to the next level by subjecting it to AirShaper's virtual online wind tunnel. This will reveal the potential for additional speed gains and stability through further optimization of the body shape. Thanks for watching, and be sure to check out Luke's two videos on the engineering, the building, and of course the flying. If you found this project intriguing, check out my other content, and be sure to subscribe to stay updated on future projects.